Good morning and welcome to Buchlyvie and Gartmore Parish Churches as we continue our worship at home during this COVID pandemic. You will have heard the saying, render unto Caesar that which is Caesar's and render unto God that which is God's. We will explore that saying of Jesus a bit more detail this morning. Let us worship God together. We sing the hymn, All My Hope in God is Founded. So let us bring our prayers to God. Let us pray. Loving and eternal God, known to us in the face of Jesus Christ, we come into your presence to worship and praise you. We come from different places, different families, and different circumstances. However, O God, we come before you today wherever we are. Whether the last week has been good or bad, whether we have known joy or sorrow, let us leave our cares and concerns aside and come united in our faith and hopes for the future. We bring our skills and our talents, which you have given us, and we promise to use them to help others, to reach out in love, showing others what it means to be a child of God. Help us not just to listen to your voice, but to obey. Help us not just to talk, but to put your words into action, so that all we do is done in your name. Gracious and merciful God, we are sorry that we seldom live up to our own expectations, let alone yours. We are sorry that our promise to follow your example and to share your never-ending love are too often promises made in vain. So forgive us, O God. We ask you to guide us and to set us on the right path. When we are weak, make us strong. When we are discouraged, encourage us. When we take for granted all that you have given us, and do not share what we have with those who have less, forgive us, O God. Remind us that everything we have comes from you, and everything we do is done for the work and the glory of your kingdom. Our prayers we offer through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We now hear the Word of God.
We hear the Word of God from the Gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 22, and reading from the 15th verse. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. May God add his blessing to this reading of his word. Amen.
Render unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's. These words of Jesus have become a kind of proverb, and those who even know little of the Bible still will have heard the phrase, "Render unto Caesar." Yet digging beneath the surface of this very short encounter, we learn something of God and his love. First, the combination of people approaching Jesus is intriguing. Matthew tells us that the Pharisees come together with the Herodians. The Pharisees did not want to give money to their pagan oppressors, and so they were opposed to paying taxes to Rome. On the other hand, King Herod's position of power came courtesy of the Romans. He was a puppet king. So even though the taxes were widely considered to be oppressive, the Herodians had a vested interest in keeping the Roman taxes paid. Therefore, the Pharisees and the Herodians each reflected a slightly different view. And then came the question, is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? This reference is obviously to Jewish law, to the law of Moses. Clearly, it was lawful to pay the tax by Roman standards. The question is, was it proper to do so in the name of God? It would seem that they have presented Jesus with no way out. He can't speak against the tax, for that would anger the Herodians and lead possibly, very likely, to a charge of treason against Rome. He could not speak in favour of the tax without alienating most of the crowd who were following alongside. Jesus asks for one of the coins used to pay the tax. In some ways, Jesus' own trap, for we are told it proves at least one among the questioners to be a hypocrite. For the coin used to pay for the tax was a silver denarius, with the image of Caesar on one side, and on the reverse, the image of a woman called Pax, or personified peace. The coins, we are told, were against Jewish law. If you remember, in the Ten Commandments, do not bow down to any graven image. And they saw the coins having a graven image of Caesar. You will also recall the incident when Jesus upset the tables of the money changers in the courts of the temple. These money changers had a business because one was required to exchange pagan Roman currency for temple coins, because in the temple you could only use temple currency. So when Jesus asks for a denarius, one is quickly located and handed to him. Jesus then asks the question that everyone in Israel could have answered even without a coin in their hand. In our reading for this morning, we used the New Revised Standard Version, which I always do. And it translates the words as, "Whose head is this and whose title?" In some ways, this translation, and it shows the weakness of English, misses the point of his argument. The word they translate as head is icon, a Greek word better translated as image. And the word title is better translated as likeness. So when they answer Jesus' question, saying that the image and likeness are Caesar's, Jesus replies that they are to give to Caesar what is Caesar's. Again, the translation covers something better revealed. It could also be translated as give back rather than just give or render. Give Caesar back those things that are Caesar's. It is his coin anyway. Who cares if you give Caesar back his coin for tax? Then Jesus gives the most amazing line of the short encounter when he continues by saying that we are to give back to God the things that are God's. It leaves everyone calculating what exactly is God's that we are supposed to give back. And in case you are wondering, the clue again is in the word icon or image and the word likeness. Jesus' answer came from Genesis chapter 1, which says, "And God said, let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness." And goes on to state that God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. So the principle is this: just as the coin has Caesar's icon on it, so it is Caesar's. We were made in the image and likeness of God, therefore we are God's, especially through our baptism. Jesus affirmed the tax while making it all but irrelevant. And Jesus implies that though we do not owe the state, there are limits to what we owe. Yet Jesus places no limits regarding what we owe back to God. You begin to live into the image and likeness of God by conforming your lives to the life of Christ. Giving back to God through the church does matter. We all need stewardship and giving. But merely giving money to the church or the government or anywhere else is only part of the image of giving back. To live more fully into that image and likeness of God that is in all of us. To give back our hearts and all that we are, for it is God's anyway. And so I suppose the question for you and for me is, what are the things that are God's, which we are to give back to him? And I suppose the answer is ourselves, for we are made beautifully in his likeness and in his image. May all that we do this week be for his glory and for the advancement of his kingdom. And may we render unto Caesar that which is Caesar's, and to give back to God that which is God's. Amen. And so let us bring our intercessions to God. Let us pray. Loving Lord, we bring to you now our prayers for others and for ourselves. Loving God, we ask that you bless and guide your church here in these parishes and throughout Scotland, particularly as we seek to reach out during this current pandemic, but sharing with them also the good news of Jesus Christ, standing with those who are most in need at this time, with our help, our love, and our support. Loving Lord, guide us in our relationships with others, within our families, with friends and neighbours, and those whom we struggle to love or try to avoid. Fill our homes and communities with the strength of your love, and may we learn to love and accept all. Gracious God, pour out your Spirit into our world. Bless those struggling with poverty and homelessness, evil and war. Help out to help us, help those in need. Merciful God, bless those who are ill at home or in hospital at this time, those who are feeling anxious or worried or low, those who are bereaved, those who have the funeral of a loved one in the coming days. Loving God, may they know your love and sense your presence. And may we as a church reach out to all in their time of need. Loving God, bless the leaders of the nations, particularly those in our own nation, for our Queen and her family, for those who serve in government in Edinburgh and in London, ensuring that they work hard for us, to represent the people and to endure for the good of all. Loving God, may we always sense your presence in our lives and in the lives of others. Transform us to be the people that you would have us be. And let us truly give to Caesar that which is Caesar's, and to give to you, O God, our all, to give to you that which belongs to you, our service, our devotion, our thanks and our praise, for all that you have done for us, especially in and through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. so may you go forward into this coming week, giving back to God that which is God's. And may you know the peace and the love of God, even in the midst of this current pandemic, and the blessing of God Almighty, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest upon you and remain with you, this day and always. Amen.
You will know that in Buchlyvie we have the funerals of two of our members in the coming days. Walter Bilsland's funeral will take place tomorrow, Monday the 19th of October, at 11:30 at Kippen Cemetery. As you know, funerals are private at this time and limited to a strict number of 20. However, if you wish to pay your respects, the family will be leaving Station Road, Walter's home, sometime just after 11 o'clock on Monday morning, if you wish to stand on either Station Road or Main Street. On Tuesday morning, Nessie Calder's funeral will take place in the church at 11 o'clock and then thereafter to Bannockburn Stirlingshire Crematorium at 12 noon. Again, Bill and family will leave Montgomery Place sometime just after 10:45. If you wish to pay your respects either before the service or if you wish to come to the church for approximately 11:20 for the hearse and family moving off towards Stirling. Again, you can stand on either Montgomery Place, Station Road or Main Street. We remember Walter and Nessie's family in our prayers and we commit them to God. Faithful servants of God's church, may they rest in peace and rise in glory. Amen.